abolish the debt inherited from ancient sin. By every succeeding generation, grant that just as many conform to him, we have borne by the law of nature the image of man and earth. So by sanctification of grace, we may bear image of the man of heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so large was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed in infirmity. One of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for our sin, for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood, but the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life. And the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt.
Oh, and reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Better that one man should die rather than the people.
Simon Peter, and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around the charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Anna sent him out to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you or are you living?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed.
Do you want me to release to you King of the Jews?
They cried out again,
not of this one, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
Hail, King of the Jews.
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and he said to them,
Behold the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered,
We have a law, and according to that law, we have to die, because you made yourself the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium, and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him, so Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you, and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release him,
Behold your king.
They cried out,
take him away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified.
Woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
Behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
There was a vessel filled with hot wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
it is finished.
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit.
Dismas heard Jesus say something that was
beyond anything the world had ever experienced. He heard this Jesus forgive all those who had been so cruel to him. Kindness and the love flowing from Jesus on his cross overwhelmed that good thief. So he prayed to the man on the cross next to him. He called out to him, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And then this distance, for Jesus promised that he would be the first to enjoy his victory. "I tell you, this day you will be with me in paradise." How often, my dear friends in Christ, do you and I sing those words? You see, they're part of a Christian song written by a man by the name of Cyril. And it's just that simple prayer of the man we call distance. "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And how many of us ever think about distance? Hopefully we make his prayer our own. Hopefully, in some way, all of us realize that we need the Lord's mercy and compassion. Hopefully, we realize that the end of Christ's life is the beginning of our eternal lives. We ask him, in deepest humility, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Maybe, my dear friends in Christ, as we listen to the words of compassion, as we venerate the cross of our salvation, maybe we need to pray the words of that good thing. Maybe we need to ask the Lord to remember us when we come into his kingdom. You see, maybe if the events of this Good Friday take effect in our lives, maybe if we truly follow that man on the cross, one day when we enter God's kingdom, we will hear those words that Dismas heard. "This day you will be with me in paradise." May God bless you.
Peace. to guard her and to reunite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading her life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty. Let us kneel. Thank you.
who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered. Look kindly on the flock at your side, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of the shepherd. Through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant. Let us kneel. Let us
bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants. Graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who not meet, do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the
the assurance of peace and freedom of religion. May through your gift be made secure. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray.
Thank you. at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope of the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours now and forever.
Thank you. Almighty, ever-living God, who restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing.
May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people, who have honored the death of your Son, in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. Through Christ our Lord.